Today we're looking into FISA, the government program that's looking into you. If you start feeling alone in social isolation, don't worry, the government's willing to listen. Yup, it's gonna be a real tinfoil hat episode today. So why am I talking about this? I figure getting on a few government watch lists will probably help my view count. FBI surveillance team, remember to like and subscribe. Oh yeah, and there's also a bill that's about to pass through Congress that will determine how much power to give FISA, or the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act, in researching people's activities. With that, let's get right into the incredibly Orwellian named USA Freedom Reauthorization Act. You can generally tell how embarrassingly unethical a bill is based on how vaguely patriotic its name is. Now, a version of this bill has already passed through the House of Representatives and the Senate. At this point, the two bodies just have to stitch together the best of both bills into a Frankenstein's monster bill that'll be sent to the president to sign. So what are the terms of this reconciliation debate? Well, the main issue is the alarming question of, should the FBI be able to spy on Americans' internet activity without a warrant? Now this argument hit a fever pitch last week in the Senate when a bipartisan coalition of Oregon Democratic Senator Ron Wyden and Montana Republican Senator Steve Daines both came together to argue, wait, you should at least need to provide a reason before you get access to anyone's internet history. Who do we look like, Google?
Is it right when millions of law-abiding Americans are at home for their government to be able to spy on their internet searches and their web browsing without a warrant?
This amendment required 60 votes to be added to the legislation, and it got, drumroll for the future of our privacy rights, 59 votes. Ooh, so close, but no cigar. So if this amendment was so universally loved, why couldn't it get 60 votes in the Senate?
These intense discussions have produced a strong bill that balances the need for accountability with our solemn obligation to protect our citizens and defend our homeland. I understand that several of our colleagues believe this compromise bill is not perfect. Sadly, imperfection is a fact of life when it comes to compromise legislation. But while I respect my distinguished colleagues whose amendments we'll be voting on later today, I would urge senators to vote against them. The current bill, in its current form, already strikes the correct and delicate balance. And there is certainly no guarantee that another new version of this legislation would necessarily pass the House or earn the President's support.
The two arguments against this amendment are, first, national security. Who saw that one coming? Now, unfortunately, my current security clearance is Google, so I can't talk much about that argument. But second was bureaucratic inertia. If there were no amendments, this bill would have passed through the Senate and immediately been on the president's desk. But because an amendment we'll get to in a second was successfully added, the Senate had to go back to the House, and here we are, creating a new compromise bill. McConnell's argument was, important parts of our national security apparatus lapsed a few months ago, and have not been reapproved yet. Let's say no to the amendments, get this compromise legislation through, and then figure everything else out later. It's the political equivalent of your dad saying, we'll see, when you ask for anything. Of course, I'm not here to talk about the past. The fight is still on, this time in House reconciliation. A strange group of advocates from the far-right Freedom Works to the ACLU and Human Rights Watch wrote an open letter to Speaker of the House Nancy Pelosi and House Minority Leader Kevin McCarthy saying, seriously, everyone hates this. Do your job and represent. You are representatives after all. Two House sources familiar with the negotiations said that California Democrat Zoe Lofgren and Ohio Republican Warren Davidson have been looking for House support for language that mirrors the Wyden-Daines Amendment and would eventually be matched back up with the Senate. Now before I move on, I want to inject any nuance into this conversation at all, because the debate is not as black and white as you might think. The warrantless internet search sphere is attached to Section 215 authorities, which lets the government collect business and other records of individuals through the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court. Now, this investigative authority cannot be used to investigate an American or crimes not related to international terrorism. So that kind of sounds like the exact opposite of allowing the government carte blanche access to your internet history. The trouble is in the application of this law, because to use this, an investigator would say, I think terrorists are using your store to, say, launder money. So give us all the records of every sale you've ever made so we can figure this out. In this case, if the feds were to issue an order for an internet service provider to turn over the internet history of all of its customers, you know, because a terrorist might have used Comcast at some point, well then Uncle Sam is going to quickly learn that I was about half of Gangnam Style's billion views. The unamended bill does not fundamentally reform the business document FISA process, leaving, for example, the vague relevance standard that has been abused in the past through secret interpretations. Now, I could do an entire episode on this relevancy standard alone, because oh boy did some government lawyer get quite the Christmas bonus for finding this loophole. The problem is, to acquire the business records, you need to prove reasonable grounds to believe the data collected is relevant to an authorized investigation. But what if the government really wants to collect data unrelated to an authorized investigation? Are they just out of luck? Well, never fear, because the government deems all records relevant, based on the fact that they are used to find patterns and connections in preventing terrorist activity. I mean, how do we know what an innocent person looks like without stealing millions of records on innocent people and running them through an algorithm? It's all relevant. Similarly, there are huge holes in the unamended bill's limitations on indefinite retention of Americans' records, and the bill fails to ensure that the American public will ever know how much of their private records have been collected. So there you go. America's current privacy protections make Facebook look ethical. The other point of contention in this negotiation is the amendment that actually passed the Senate and triggered this whole reconciliation process. This amendment was brought to you by Vermont Democrat Patrick Leahy and Utah Republican Mike Lee. Now, when you think of a court, you probably imagine a prosecutor and a defender pointing their hands around and yelling, "I'm out of order, this whole court's out of order." In the case of the FISA court, though, the government approaches the court for a warrant and there's nobody to argue the rights of the person being surveilled. It's hard to provide a legal defense for someone who doesn't even know their case is being argued in court. The government requests thousands of FISA warrants each year, and while this amendment would not sit a defender in every hearing, it does set up a special case of sensitive investigative matters where a defense lawyer would be present. Now, these would include investigations involving the activities of a domestic public official or domestic political candidate, a religious or domestic political organization or individual prominent in such an organization, or the news media. You know, the exact people you don't want the government to have the ability to launch a partisan investigation into with zero accountability. So those are going to be the two arguments over FISA regulation that are going to be happening over the reconciliation period next week. The exciting thing here is that there is a broad bipartisan coalition supporting protecting American privacy rights. In fact, the amendment that would have required a warrant for tracking Americans' online activity would have gotten the 60 votes to pass if one of its four absent supporters, Patty Murray, Bernie Sanders, Lamar Alexander, or Ben Sasse, had been present to vote. If you have some free time this week and you care about this, consider calling your representative. It might be a close vote and it isn't getting much attention, so your participation could actually shift someone's vote. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello, YouTube. First, I'd like to thank my patrons for helping me put out my videos. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan news looking into the overlooked, join this growing list of exceptional individuals by clicking on that link in the description. Also remember to subscribe and ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring. Give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw, and lastly, as always, thank you for watching.